I love Friday.
Dueling Zora.
Hello and welcome back to Rocky Minute, the daily podcast where we kick off 2 weeks of coma coverage one long minute at a time. I'm your host, Doug.
And I'm Jason. Did I put on the pack? Yep, I'm Jason.
And joining us again on this Friday, we have our pal Sully from Sully Baseball. Paul Sullivan, welcome, buddy.
Hey, how are you? And you and I were referencing the right stuff before we started here. And I said, let's light this candle. And I just realized something, that in terms of I'm a big sort of student of the history of the Oscars, and a lot of times someone will win an Oscar, and it isn't necessarily for the thing that they should have won the Oscar for, but they do makeups. You know, it's like, oh, man, you know, it's like Pacino winning for Scent of a Woman was, oh man, really? We didn't give Pacino an Oscar? We got to give him an Oscar. You know, you know, that happens with Scorsese for The Departed.
Yeah.
Departed's a fine film, but that clearly was, oh man, Raging Bull, Goodfellas, Taxi Driver, really? He has never won? You know, so I realized there's a little bit of that with The Right Stuff and Rocky, because The Right Stuff is the only Academy Award won by Bill Conti, who wrote all the great music for the Rocky films. And he was nominated for Rocky and Gonna Fly Now for Best Song, but it didn't win. I don't remember what won. And the best score that year, he wasn't nominated for at all. It went to The Omen and Jerry Goldsmith. And so there's Bill Conti never having won an Oscar. And he finally got to win an Oscar, and it was for The Right Stuff. And so that was a little – and don't get me wrong, The Right Stuff has an amazing score. But there was a little bit of, oh, man, we did not give an Oscar to the dude who wrote Rocky's theme. Oh, man, we got – here you go.
Yeah. You know, I mean, he's like, known for this, but he gets the Oscar for that. You know, all right.
Bill Conti has an Oscar, not for Rocky, but he has an Oscar, mm-hmm. So –
well, he deserves it for Rocky for sure.
Yeah.
So. But today, we're knocking out minute 75, which begins with Dr. Cooper, and it ends with Rocky walking into Adrian's hospital room. Whoa. They only show a little tidbit of it, but we got a long, long hospital room wait in the waiting room. I think everybody can relate to that.
Yeah. And I remember, I'm a father of two, and I remember lots of times my wife went into a premature labor. It didn't become as dramatic as this, but there was a lot of days where we went into the hospital for early contractions, and I'd be sitting in a lobby in New York in St. Luke's Roosevelt Hospital, just sitting like this. And I love that you have no idea how long they've been sitting there, but you know they didn't just get there.
No.
But also, while they're both sitting here in the hospital, they're both sitting. Hold on a second. I messed up. Yeah, edit this out later. But they're both sitting here. They both are, you know. I wanted to say something, but no, I shut it down and then I can't. So they're both sitting here, and you got to think that like both of them probably feel responsible for this, because what the doctor's going to say to them is that it was from stress from being pregnant and overworked. Mm-hmm. So like Rocky's probably thinking that this happened because she went back to work in the pet shop and was carrying the garbage can of whatever around. And Paulie probably feels guilty because he was just yelling at her before this. Yeah. It was at a gong. Paulie probably feels guilty because he was just yelling at her right when this happened. So they're both like, you have the concern, the worry about what's going on here, about that she hopes she's going to be okay. But you're also, both of them are probably feeling a lot of guilt, and they each think it's their fault. And Rocky doesn't know that Paulie was yelling at her right before this happened. So Rocky probably thinks it's all his fault.
Well, that's a perfect segue, Jay.
Also, real quick, to ruin the segue, is there's so many other chairs in this waiting room. We could see two of them and scream. Why are they both sitting on the same chair?
Same chair? Let me see.
Yeah, there's no separation between the two.
No.
That's funny.
Go ahead. What did I segue into?
You segued into the book because because they have a little waiting room blurb here of what Rocky's thinking. I was thinking all kinds of stupid thoughts about what happened. If it were me who caused it, or whether Paulie had caused it. And if Paulie did cause it, I swear to God, I was gonna, nah, forget that. That ain't gonna help nothing. Because if I started thinking along those lines in 5 minutes, I would jump all over Paulie, and I wouldn't even know if he was guilty of nothing. He had always argued with his sister, so I couldn't go punching him now and expect that would change anything. So he kind of assumed that it was Paulie.
Right.
This is inner monologue of Rocky. I prefer the silence.
Because the last time Rocky saw Paulie, it was when Rocky was training. Paulie was he was on his way out to go fix things with Adrian. So God only knows. Rocky has no idea what Paulie had said to her.
Right.
Yeah. I like this. This is just quiet. The two don't have to say anything to each other. Mm-hmm. And that. And, you know, Paulie has nothing resembling a neck. He just is sort of, he's just sunk so deep into that chair. It reminds me of a little bit of when Fredo was in that bouncy chair in Lake Tahoe during the I'm smart scene Godfather 2. And he just looks like he has no bones in his body while he's doing that. And Paulie just looks totally filleted here. He just looks like he's just a bag of skin, and
he lost weight before this movie was filmed. So I mean, he doesn't look any thinner than old Paulie there, the way he is.
Yeah, but it's also you could dress someone and make them look rumpled and everything. And it wasn't that Paulie was a big fat guy. It was that he was disheveled, mm-hmm. And so even if Burt Young, the actor, trimmed down. Paulie can be a nice hot mess, and even if he's trim, it's just sort of it's how he's dressed, it's his posture. I mean, look at him. He just looks like he's got no spine there. And of course, next to Stallone, and he's that's kind of who he is.
Yeah, they're sitting on the same couch, like on the same level, but Paulie looks like he's so much lower in the seat than Rocky is.
Yeah.
That's weird.
So the doctor comes in.
Yeah, Dr. Cooper, an actress named Rotania Alda, a Latvian actress. She's
what?
A Latvian. She's from the country Latvia.
Oh, yeah.
Still working today. She was in films such as The Deer Hunter, Mommy Dearest, Amityville Horror 2, The Possession. Our buddy Ryan Rabalkin, who hosts Going the Distance, the Rocky Series podcast, actually interviewed her for his show. So, look up Going the Distance and check out that interview.
Yes.
So what we have here now, if you look around the hospital, this isn't the Pennsylvania hospital. This is Saint something, because there's a huge crucifix behind her.
Yeah.
There's nurses and nuns in the hallway. There's like three nuns there. She tells them that the baby is fine, even though it's a month premature.
She doesn't get a close up though. Like she walks in, and then the rest of it is the back of her head. And then a slow zoom into Stallone and his reaction. And I get why they're doing that. I get why he did that, because first of all, he's the director. Maybe a shot of me would be good here.
Yeah.
But you want to see Rocky in what should be one of the great moments of his life turn into a moment of real pain.
Yeah.
I can relate to that to a degree, because the day my twin boys were born, my son Aiden was in the NICU and his lungs didn't open properly. Mm-hmm. And I asked the nurse, he's going to be all right, right? And she's like, well, no, in the morning. So the first night of me being a dad, I wasn't jumping up and down.
No,
I was this hot mess of, oh my God, I can't, the twin boys, and one of them has like a Darth Vader mask on his face. And now he's this, he grew up as a nice, big, healthy boy. But
right. That
first night, this scene hits a little home for me, because it's like I'm a father, but I'm depressed. I'm all I can feel is sadness. Mm-hmm. And so there's the fact that happens and is happening, that that it is a wallop of of an emotion. And I like the fact that Stallone plays it with kind of a blank canvas, that he doesn't try to you know, emote. Because I remember when, you know, when they told me, I didn't break down crying. I didn't. I just was kind of like, I kind of had this thousand yard stare.
Right.
And what so I think. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to make this sad. My boy is fine. He's, yeah. It's not, you know, he's a teenager now. But yeah, I mean, that's, you know, that's something that is, you know, they stay on him. But I feel badly for the doctor. She's, you know, she has this, her big scene, and she doesn't get a close-up. You know, as an actress. I'm sure they did coverage of her. I said, you can cut to me once? You
right.
Me. you know, you can, my one dramatic reveal, and all you see is the back of my head, you know?
It might as well be like, you know, when they start zooming in on Stallone, like, or on Rocky, and like a disembodied voice that's just, like, echoing through his head. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like he's not, like, you know, when in Breaking Bad, when the doctor tells Walter White he's got cancer, it's just a zoom in on Walter White, and the doctor's voice is like a faraway echo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, so it's kind of like that, you know?
Yeah, and then... You know, then they start walking down the hallway.
Well, she said interesting point I noticed. She says it's a month premature, not he's. Do they not always like refer to baby from their gender, by their gender?
Maybe she's not saying that. Maybe she's not referring to the baby. Maybe she's referring to the pregnancy, like the pregnancy.
Yeah, the month is the pregnancy.
Okay.
It's premature.
Or is she is she careful about not knowing what the baby wants to identify as?
Oh, that's true.
And sure. You know, so she's doing
she's ahead of her time.
Yeah,
she's ahead
of her time. Right. In New York now, you can put an X at the gender that's beginning. Right. And they let them pick it later.
I this has nothing to do with anything. And I was saying to you guys, I wanted to get going, but I'm naturally going to derail it with something else. When my boys, where it was clear the boys were going to be okay, you know, the next day it was like, okay, yeah, his lungs open and great. Mm-hmm. I had a moment when I was alone in one of the rooms, the NICU, and they handed me, it was in Manhattan, and they handed me these sheets. And they were, I had the job of filling out their names. And this is what was going to appear on the official birth certificate as issued from the state of New York. And I realized the power I had in my possession at that point. That I could have named him Obi-Wan Kenobi, Veal Parmigiana, Sullivan if I wanted to. And officially, New York would have to give me a birth certificate with Obi-Wan Kenobi, Veal Parmigiana, Sullivan as the name of my boy. Fortunately,
you showed some restraint.
Cooler heads prevailed, and I wrote the two boys' names the way that they're supposed to be.
That's but pretty funny.
That I didn't even have to put Sullivan at the end. I could have called him, you know, Slap Maxwell Xylophone Cambodia. Boom, that's his name. Legally. Slap, come over here. You
know? Slap.
That moment, because I was remembering, wait a minute, I'm spelling it the right way, right? A-N, right? Because Dwayne Wade's name... You know, the basketball player from the Heat, his name is spelled D-Y-W-A-N-E because his mother misspelled it on the goddamn birth certificate thing. Oh, and so forever, it's D-Y-W-A-N-E. And so, you know, I was like, oh, God, spell the name right, Sullivan, Sullivan. It's Sullivan. Don't write S-U-L-L-E-Y. Come on, Sullivan.
You double check, you triple check.
You get one shot at this. This is going to Albany. Yeah.
Well, that's good. It worked out for everybody except Dwayne Wade.
Exactly. Well, Dwayne's done okay. He is what, 3 world championship rings, millions of dollars in the bank, and he's going to the Hall of Fame.
I think typo on his name doesn't really matter anymore.
Yeah.
Rocky here seems like not that he couldn't care less about the baby, but still his focus is now and always will be on Adrian.
Yeah.
She, you know, says the baby's healthy, and then Paulie's the one that asks what is it. She says it's a boy, and again, like I said, Rocky's just asking about Adrian. How's Adrian? And this is where it gets a little heavy because the doctor starts talking about the complications.
Yeah,
we get a music note here. The sad music starts, and here's like Stallone and his great nonverbal acting.
Yeah. There's a lot of, as me being a lapsed Catholic here, there's a lot of Christian imagery here. Like when he's, you know, you mentioned when the doctor was walking in, there's a big crucifix. When he's walking up the hall, you see one of the crucifixes are there on the left. And of course, he's got a cross hanging from his neck. And as he's walking up the hallway, there's another kind of, I don't know if either one of you are Catholic or not, but there's one of the kind of the Stations of the Cross things on the side
statues
of the wall.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I had to actually pause for a second because for a second, I thought her room number was 666.
Yeah.
Now it turns out it's 669, but for a minute I rewound it because you could see for a second 669, but for when I wasn't paying attention, you know, I was distracted by the tiger on the back of his jacket.
Yeah.
But I thought, like, if he had Adrian in room 666, that just would have been too intense. That would have been like he's his Rocky's descent into hell, and you know, and has the devil taken poor Adrian.
Do you know what they call the number 669? It does have some religious undertones.
The devil's orgy? I don't know.
They call it the angel number. What I found here is the number 6 can symbolize a new beginning and a much better life. This number advises you to start over, to begin a new life, which will be based on the strong emotions and feelings. This number tells you to follow your heart and listen to your intuition.
And you call this number, rate supply, and it's $5.95 a minute. I don't know.
Now, because 6 is listed twice, the number 2 also has a special power, and it's strongly connected to the number 6. The number is related to intuition and instincts. This number also symbolizes physical abilities, spiritual strength, peace, and calmness. You still want to question my color theory, Jay?
Yes.
His blue shirt?
Is this all in the novelization? What are you reading from?
No, this I found this on a website.
Oh, so you know it's true.
Yeah, it has to be. It's on the internet.
I was thinking when we go into the room and you see Adrian there, you know, in her coma, and there's a lot of coma coming up here.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just thinking about Talia Sher in these scenes, that for her, these must have been the best days at work. It's just like, I'm going to come in. I'm going to lay down. I don't have any lines. I'm just going to keep my eyes shut. And that's my day for weeks and weeks and weeks. Her day, she checks the call sheet. Oh, I'm in bed again. Okay.
There's no manner of directing Stallone could give her. Just lay there and close your eyes.
Just make sure your eyes don't open. Just keep your head to the side. You know? I talked a little bit in the minute about some of my problems I had with Rocky II. Again, I will emphasize, I like Rocky II. It's not, I don't think it's a bad movie, but I do have some issues with it. I think even the place, you know, I mentioned the scene when he had this argument with Mickey in the locker room, felt a little forced. Like, it's like, well, I gotta have a scene with Mickey here. And so it just sort of shows up. And I think the coma just sort of shows up. You know, that you know, yeah, she had a complication of the pregnancy, but like, okay, now we're not, like, all of a sudden we're now in a coma movie.
Mm-hmm.
And of course you're going to feel something because, you know, this is one of the great screen romances of all time. You know, you spent the whole movie wanting Rocky and Adrian to get together. And so the fact that he would lose her at the moment that should be their apex, of course, but it also feels a little like, and she's in a coma. And so we're going to cry over that. And it feels a little forced. And again, forgive me, because I'm going to talk a little, I'm going to talk down about this movie a little bit. It gets to my biggest problem with Rocky II, which is it kind of wants to have its cake and eat it too. You know what I mean? That it wants to have the realism of the first Rocky, but it still wants to also have the crowd-pleasing sequel, wants to be a crowd-pleasing almost action movie. And in this film, it's a little bit like in a transition. It's like, it's not sure, should you go all in to sort of Rocky being a superhero, or do we keep it grounded in reality? And it's a little bit of a middle ground.
Mm-hmm.
What I love about Rocky III, and I like Rocky III better than I like Rocky II, and I think a lot of people like Rocky III better than they like Rocky II. I think if you talk to Rocky fans, I think that most of them would say the first Rocky is their favorite, and then probably I think a lot would say Rocky III. Or I guess it depends on which was the one first one you saw in the theater.
Right.
But by Rocky III, they just embrace the cartoon. They embrace he's a hero. He's basically a superhero.
Yeah.
And you can even see in the posters, like in the first one, he's all beaten up. And this one, he's kind of bruised. And then the Rocky III, his hair is perfect. His muscles are glistening. He's in front of like a clouds, you know, with the championship belt in front of him.
That's right, yeah.
And of course, by Rocky IV, he is Captain America. But there's this film kind of is a feathered fish. Like it's a little cartoony, but a little realistic, and we got to hit these emotional moments, and they kind of feel a little forced. And then you have the cartoon fight at the end, which spoiler, I'm not going to spoil what happens in the fight at the end, but it's a little over the top, and by that I mean over the top, not Stallone arm wrestling anybody, but. Stallone over the top,
yeah.
Golang Globus reference. I hope you get during this entire time here.
I love over the top.
Yeah, over the top. Over the top is exactly what it is. If you're flipping around on TV or you're like doing chores and it's on in the background, it's a dumb Golang Globus film that is good to have on in the background. But mm-hmm. as a movie, you know, it's insane. But anyway. But that's my main issue with Rocky II, is that it wants to be Rocky I and Rocky III. You know, it wants to be that's kind right. of – it wants to be the realistic emotional film, but it also wants to be a superhero film. And its feet are on two different planes. The first one is a realistic movie. There's no getting around it. It feels real. It feels visceral. Right. Rocky III feels like an episode of the Super Friends. And this is kind of the cocoon. And by that, I mean the metamorphosis, not Wilford Brimley and Don Ameche swimming in a pool getting horny.
I thought you were referring to the movie.
I haven't seen that movie in a long time. I loved that movie when it came out. I wonder if it holds up. I really wonder if it holds up. But anyway, I mean, it sounds nitpicky, and I guess in a way it is, because in the end, Rocky II is fine. It does the job. It basically was, I want to see Rocky again, but Rocky win. You know, that's basically the purpose of this movie. And there's also, I can't help but wonder what would have happened if Paradise Alley or Fist had become very successful movies. Because if they were, would Stallone, you know, because Stallone was billed in the original Rocky, in the trailers and in all the publicity for it, as this great new movie star in the like Pacino or De Niro. And I wonder if Fist or Paradise Alley had hit, for those of you wondering, those are the two films he made right after Rocky and before Rocky II. If those films had hit, I wonder if he would have even done sequels to Rocky. He's like, no, I'm moving on. That was a film I made. It was a hit, but I'm now doing other things. Or if the sequel to Rocky and the rematch with Apollo were just inevitable. But, you know, I wonder, you know, how that would have changed his life. But anyway, it's my issue with Rocky II. Is it, and these scenes where there's kind of a forced argument with Mickey in the locker room and suddenly a forced coma to hit the emotional buttons, it hit my issues with the film. And they're nitpicky. In the end, I like the movie. But in terms of rewatching a Rocky film,
this isn't your go-to.
It's not my go-to. Like, I'll rewatch the first one any day of the week. And I find myself rewatching the third one. The fourth one, the one with Drago, is amazing because I think there's 20 minutes of original footage in the film. And the rest of it's montage.
Yeah, I think you're right.
And I watched I told you, I watched 1 through 4 with my kids, and they loved them. And when Mickey, spoiler alert for Rocky III, when Mickey died, there were tears the size of basketballs flowing down my son's face.
Really? Wow.
But when we were watching Rocky IV, and they loved Rocky III. They loved, loved, loved Rocky III. But when I showed them Rocky IV, and there was like the third or fourth montage, my son Aiden just kind of bubbled under his breath, more clips.
So even back then, he realized.
Yeah, he was 11 years old. They got more clips.
That's great.
That's my boy.
That was the crap that I loved back then, right?
Yeah, because it was the Rocky films adapt. I mean, it's funny that people joke like, oh, it's the same story over and over, but it's not true. They adapt. Mm-hmm. Like it was a realistic 70s, gritty 70s film. And then it really became 80s, MTV, Eye of the Tiger and everything. Sure. And then it was kind of, propaganda. And then there was that sort of nostalgia of pop culture that came through in Rocky Balboa, and then sort of a reinvention with Creed. I mean, it adapts like crazy. And I think that's one of the reasons why it stayed relevant, is because its adaptations are subtle. It's kind of like the way James Bond films adapt for each decade. It's the same wine, but different ways to bottle it.
Right.
And
here we are still talking about it 40 something years later.
And it's still relevant. A big part because of the success of the Creed films, but even without them, it's like you stand on top of a stairway and jump up and down with your arms up in the air. Everyone knows that. It's just, it's iconic. So anyway, it's my nitpicking of it. And, but it's still, it's fun. Rocky II is fun, but it's not nearly as fun as 1 or 3.
Well, I can understand and appreciate your opinion on it. I mean, the beauty of doing what we do is that, everybody has a different opinion. So we have a forum to take as many different opinions as we can handle,
Yeah.
And listen to them all. So we appreciate it. I mean, we can't thank you enough for coming on and making time in your schedule for us.
Yeah, and I pity to paraphrase Clever Lang, I pity the fool who has to do all these coma minutes.
Yeah, those are gonna be tough, man. Those are gonna be tough minutes.
Bring a book.
So why don't you one last time tell the fans, about Sully Baseball and where they can find it?
Go to check me out at Sully Baseball on Twitter, and I'm going to be relaunching the podcast very soon. Certainly by the time the baseball season begins, we're going to be doing lots of interesting things and having some great guests and having some interactions as my beloved Red Sox try to ease the pain of Boston fans who just wanted to see their team win 5 World Series in their lifetime.
Yeah, it's been a rough decade so far. Rough decade.
I know. This is a tough time for Boston sports fans. It's been months since there's been a parade.
No, it's nice time for Boston fans.
I know. I keep telling my Boston sports fans, beware, because this will come crashing down eventually. Mm-hmm. It's been 2 great decades back to back. There's going to be a crap decade. So
it's bound to happen.
Just pile
it's
up
start
the
on Sunday. You're crashing down.
It could happen. It could happen. Just as long as the Red Sox keep winning, I'm happy. That's all I care about.
Okay. Good luck with the relaunch of the podcast. Yeah, and when we come up for Rocky III, what do you say? You join us again?
Oh, I pity the fool who doesn't ask me to be on
that. All right, man. Well, we're Rocky Minute, wherever you can find podcasts. Doinggenre.com is our host website. Rate, subscribe, review, whatever the saying is. And have a great weekend, and we'll see you on a brand new Rocky Minute.
What are we waiting for? Take this!
You know what I feel badly for? Hmm. What actress I feel badly for is the late Sylvia Meals.
Right.
That she was Apollo Creed's wife, and she passed away in 2010, I think, 2011. And so, her role is played by
Felicia Rashad
in the Creed films. So it's like, if she had lived, I wonder if they would have brought her back. Rest in peace.